I'm very, very pleased and honoured to be chairing the meeting today. And we've got three speakers who I'll introduce as they're going to speak. So first I'd like to introduce Mark George, who is a socialist barrister. He's represented at the Hillsborough Inquest, 22 families there, but has been working on the Orgreave campaign. So I'm going to introduce Mark first. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Some of these images will be familiar to most people in the room. Some of them are from the day of the Battle of Orgreave, so-called. One or two of them are not. I suppose the police would say they depict rioters. They do. The rioters are the guys on the horses. Before I go any further, though, as the chair said, I was one of the lawyers working for 22 of the families involved in the Hillsborough disaster, and I was working on the inquest for 2 years up until last year. And it was a fantastic result for the families, and it was brilliant to hear the four women of the jury answer 14 questions, every single one of which meant that the authorities, whether it was the police, the ambulance service, the local authority, the football club, were responsible for the Hillsborough disaster and not the fans and those who went there and suffered so badly that day. But I want to start by saying that we would never have got to those inquests and the families would never have had their opportunity to put the record right if it hadn't been for an amazing campaign over 25 often desolate years for the families when nobody seemed to want to listen to people they probably regarded as whinging scousers who would not take no for an answer. And that campaign was fought over all those years by the families tirelessly. And Sheila Coleman, who is also speaking, was one of the key figures in the campaigns. And I would like to pay tribute to Sheila for the fantastic work she did during that campaign. Thank you very much. I'm going to talk to you, though, primarily about Orgreave, because in one sense, and I say this slightly advisedly, in one sense, Hillsborough has won. I know that there are now going to be prosecutions, and we are now into the period of accountability, which is going to be very important. Orgreave hasn't got to that stage yet. Why does Orgreave still matter so long after the events? Well, partly because one of the roles of the Revolutionary Party is to act as the memory of the class. And we don't just talk about things like Orgreave because we like to reminisce about great old days back in the 1980s when you could have a good old fight with the coppers and all the rest of it. It's because there are serious lessons to be learned there, one of which is the role of the police in our society. Somebody was saying in the meeting I went to last night about how there's a feeling that at the moment we should be being pro-police. You know, the idea that we should be having an extra 10,000 police officers on the streets is something we should all be cheering for. Well, the police like to pretend that they are just there to help little old ladies across the roads and possibly bother with a burglary now and then. But actually, when the chips are down and when the interests of the state are being threatened, they become bodies of armed men, and they are the last stage before the army are actually called in. And what you saw during the miners' strike in general, and at Orgreave in particular, was the militarization of an industrial dispute, and there are serious questions that remain unanswered about that. Not the least of which is, as happened at Hillsborough, the police seized the news agenda and blamed the miners. They said, the miners attacked us at Orgreave on that day, and we had to respond in the only way we can by arresting these violent pickets. They were aided in that false narrative by the BBC, who'd filmed the whole thing. And then somehow or other, and they later apologized, managed to play the footage in the wrong order, so that you saw miners throwing missiles at the police, and then you saw the police charging at the miners. Well, they had switched it around. And they said it was just an accident. Well, you can no doubt be the judges of that. But the one thing we do know is this had been set up. There were 6,000 police officers at Orgreave on the 18th of June 1984 in a small police district, South Yorkshire. And 6,000 police officers from about 10 different forces do not descend on a small area like South Yorkshire without an awful lot of organisation. And that organisation obviously included the chief constables, but I am absolutely convinced that that sort of organisation could not possibly have been allowed to happen without the say-so of the political masters. And that's the Tory government, headed, of course, by Margaret, and I'll wait for the booze, Thatcher. Thank you. And her Home Secretary, Leon Britton. And there is just no... More booze. There is no way that that could have been organised without the absolute involvement of the government in what we all know was a very political strike. Mostly, if you got arrested on picket lines during the miners' strike, you got charged with obstructing a police officer or threatening behaviour. If it was a really rough day, you might get the odd person charged with assault police. Generally speaking, people were fined, bound over to keep the peace, and nothing much happened. But by the date of the 18th of June 1984, the 100th day of picketing at the Orgreave coking plant, a decision had been made at the very top of the South Yorkshire Police that the miners were going to be taught a lesson. They were going to be charged with offences such as unlawful assembly and riot. In those days, this is before the Public Order Act, they were what were called common law offences, and they carried a maximum of life imprisonment. And after the 18th of June, a number of there were 95 people charged either with riot or violent disorder. A large number of them were remanded in custody at Armley Jail in Leeds, and I don't know if any of you know Armley Jail. It's a place I have to go to with monotonous regularity to visit clients. It's a horrible place. And there were a large number of miners who were on remand there for a number of weeks before they eventually got bail. In terror, these guys who had never been in trouble in their lives before, who had no fear of going several hundred feet underground and digging out coal to keep the country's industries running, in terror of the thought that they were actually going to be going to prison, if not for life, for very long periods of time. So when Amber Rudd announced that there was not going to be an Orgreave inquiry and said as one of her reasons there was no miscarriage of justice at Orgreave, I say bollocks to that. Those people being remanded in custody were a miscarriage of justice. Now, during the riot trials, and if you want to and have the stamina, all of the transcripts, or virtually all of them, from the one riot trial that did take place are actually on the website of the Orgreave campaign. I read a lot of transcripts in my job, and I can tell you these are hard going. But if you persevere and you get to about day 24 of the trial, you suddenly hit the gold seam. Because police officers were pushed into a situation where they had to admit collusion. It was perfectly obvious from the witness statements, with large paragraphs, identical, amongst different police officers from different police forces involved in different arrests at different times of the day, who could not possibly have recorded exactly the same thing. But here they all were, saying all the same things. And in 2012, the BBC, perhaps to atone for their sins, asked me to have a look at a bundle of the witness statements that they'd obtained from one of the miners, which I'm fairly sure, having looked at them, were from one of the miners still awaiting trial, because they were different officers involved. But very interesting to notice what happened there. And these slides that I'm going to show you illustrate the point about collusion. So in this first example here, you can see officers who wrote periodically, there was missile throwing from the back of the pickets. Now that, as you can see, was 13 police officers, four different police forces, involved in eight separate arrests. How about from time to time? Or on occasions? All of them saying periodically? Interesting. Let's have a look at another one. Periodically, there was missile throwing from the back of the pickets, but apart from this, there was no trouble. 27 officers, four forces, 15 different arrests, all saying the same thing. And then this long passage with a couple of minor variations. At about 5 to 8 that morning, empty coke wagons, some said lorries, drove into the plant and the pickets were shouting, "Here we go, here we go," and charged the police ranks stroke lines. There were both police officers and pickets knocked to the ground. Eventually the pickets were repelled and they retreated. There was, however, a continual barrage of missiles. Now, if I picked 26 of you and asked you to explain in your own words what had just happened, I doubt if any of you would get much, if any, of these repetitions. What about eventually the pickets were repelled and they retreated? What about pushed back or fell back or any number? You can think of them faster than I can, I'm sure. And this was in no less than 27 police officers' statements from the day. Here's another one. At about 8:15, shields were taken to the front ranks to protect other officers from stones being thrown and some said missiles. 24 officers, 12 different arrests at different times of the day. At about 08:35, Assistant Chief Constable Clements, some of them said a senior officer, went to the front of the police lines and told the pickets to retreat 100 yards or he would deploy horses and officers carrying short shields and staffs. And then just a final flurry here. This one, the pickets failed to retreat and he repeated his announcement. There continued to be a hail of missiles, 25 officers from 13 different arrests. Then the front ranks opened and the police horses trotted through the lines towards the pickets. That wasn't actually true. If you see the footage, they were galloping. And then finally, three other officers with a slight variation on that theme. It took me about 3 minutes when I was presented with this bundle of statements to start seeing the patterns that are illustrated on the screen here. And although at the trial there were different officers involved in different arrests, exactly the same pattern of officer after officer after officer writing the same thing. Now, these were quite short witness statements, many of them not much more than two sides of A4 paper, and these paragraphs generally took up about a page and a half. And then what had happened was the officer would then write down, "I then saw Jones throwing stones at the police. I went forward, grabbed hold of him, said you are under arrest. He said, well, you've got to do something, haven't you? And I arrested him." Now, it came out at the trial back in 1985 that this is what the police had done. And after 48 days of the trial, the prosecution threw in the towel. They didn't even wait until they'd finished presenting the whole of their case because they realized how bad it had got, because it got to a stage where officer after officer was put in a situation of having to admit that this had been dictated to them by other officers. Dictated by officers who weren't even there. They didn't know what was happening. This happened this morning with this, so I may need to use the other one if it gets bad. Yeah. But you had officers being forced to admit that this was what had happened, and this was just collusion on a very grand scale. They tried to explain it away by saying this was just setting the scene, because a lot of these officers came from outside police forces and they didn't know the names of the streets around Orgreave, so we'll just help them along, shall we? But this isn't scene setting, this is making it up. And not only is it making it up, it's fitting them up, and the miners were fitted up in this way. Now, I'm just going to finish because I've literally very nearly run out. The key thing about this is what the Hillsborough inquest achieved was the official record, the state record, now reflects the truth. Because everybody knows, including David Cameron, and it was such a sweet day watching that Tory toff stand up in Parliament and have to admit that it was the police who had fucked it up so royally, excuse my French, so royally at Hillsborough, that was the outcome of it. But that's because we went through that process, the legal process, and got that result. Orgreave, the miners who were there, the other pickets who were there, their families and their friends, they all know the truth about Orgreave. It's obvious for anyone, it's staring you in the face. But the official record still says it was a miners' riot against the police, and the police were just doing their job. And the reason that we need an inquiry into Orgreave is to set that official record right. If you haven't been to the stall, it's at the back of the hall. Please go there afterwards. Amongst other things, there's a very useful leaflet that sets out 10 reasons, and there are plenty more, why we need an inquiry, and also some information about the sort of inquiry that we want to take place. And it's not one like it looks like they're going to get at Grenfell, as you'd probably not be surprised to hear me say. But that's the important thing. At the end of the Hillsborough inquest, there were huge banners hung up outside St George's Hall in the centre of Liverpool with two words, truth and justice. If you don't get the truth out there, the real truth, not the government's fake news, how can you ever get justice? And it's exactly the same with Orgreave. The Orgreave slogan, as on my T-shirt, is a truth and justice campaign, because you need to have the truth in order to get justice. And that's why it's so important. And obviously, we're thrilled that it was in the Labour manifesto. And if we, as and when we do get a Labour government, hopefully later this year, they will be held to that promise of an inquiry into what happened at Orgreave. Because as Mike Mansfield said a long time ago, one of the QCs in the case, Orgreave represents one of the biggest cover-ups by the state in history. It's time the truth was told. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Mark. Next speaker is going to be Barbara Jackson, who is the Secretary of the Orgreave Truth and Justice Campaign. Barbara.
Thank you. Can you hear me all right? Good. I'd really like to thank Mark for saving me a lot of time by describing what happened 33 years ago and setting the scene so graphically. As Phoebe's just described, I'm Secretary of the Orgreave Truth and Justice Campaign. It started in Sheffield in South Yorkshire nearly 5 years ago. I literally live about 5 or 6 miles away from Orgreave, so geographically and politically and emotionally, it's very, very close, you know, to my heart. And I'm unusual because I was on strike for the year of 84-85. I worked for the National Coal Board at the time in a large admin office in Sheffield. So I'm that rare thing in the miners' strike, a woman. There were a few of us working in admin roles, or women working in the canteens or cleaning. So we were there. And you all know about Women Against Pit Closures. They kept the strike going for the year. But like I say, I'm very grateful for Mark describing and showing the graphic photographs. And Mark and Sheila were our inspiration to start the campaign almost 5 years ago. When Mark appeared on television the autumn of 2012, we were amazed. We'd no idea that a programme was being made about Orgreave. And then the Hillsborough panel hearing a bit earlier had made their verdict about, yeah, the fans' version is true. And that was a huge inspiration to us. And so we decided to start the campaign in South Yorkshire for a full public inquiry. We'd no idea what we meant or how we would do it, but we hit the spot. We were geographically located. We were located near to the NUM in Barnsley. We were located near to pits that had been closed. And politically, it was the right thing to do. The miners and everybody who was on strike for that year was up against all forces of the state. The government, the judiciary, the social security system, the media as well. All forces of the state. And to hang out for a year is just an incredible achievement. We got going and hit the ground running by saying we're going to call for a full public inquiry. We're not going to go through any lower levels. We're going to go for the ultimate. And the time was right. The window of opportunity was right. People were reflecting on what was happening to the coal industry. What had happened to the trade union movement when confidence in collective action was at an all-time low, trade union membership was at an all-time low, can be traced back to the defeat in 1985. So we were new kids on the block, got a very favourable hearing from the media, eventually got the Parliamentary Labour Party to take some notice of us in the shape of Andy Burnham, who 18 months ago, a year ago, was really instrumental in driving this to the top of the political agenda. We met with Theresa May 2 years ago and she agreed to receive our Lidl submission. We gave her that 6 months later and she sat on it for 6 months. And then we got swept up into the EU referendum. And all of a sudden, she wasn't Home Secretary, she was the unelected Prime Minister. And then we were dealing with Amber Rudd, an unknown quantity to us. And we met her once, and she agreed to a timetable for a decision, which was to be a decision by the end of October last year, about whether she would grant any type of inquiry into Orgreave. And it's worth reflecting on the four reasons that she gave. Principally, there'd been no deaths, so it wasn't worthwhile having an investigation into assault by the police on the miners because nobody died. It wasn't for the want of the police trying that nobody died on that day. The second one was that there were no wrongful convictions. There weren't any convictions because the trial collapsed, but it wasn't for want of the state trying. There were no miscarriages of justice, but what is a trial that collapsed after 6 weeks if not a miscarriage of justice? And then to add insult to injury, if you live in South Yorkshire, the fourth reason was that there were no new lessons for police forces to learn by investigating what had happened at Orgreave. We're still hanging on there. We're exploring all types of legal ways forward, all types of political ways forward. We managed to get it into the Labour Party manifesto this time under Jeremy Corbyn. He's made no political capital out of supporting the Orgreave campaign, but he's been with us right from the beginning. And it's on page 80, if you're interested, of the Labour Party manifesto, that if he gets into power, he will launch an investigation into Orgreave. So we still believe that there is everything to play for. We're a voluntary campaign. We raise money by selling things and by donations. So please go and buy our remaining stuff on the table so we don't have to trundle it all the way back to Sheffield on the train. Thank you, everybody.
Thanks very much for that. Our final speaker to kick off this session is Sheila Coleman, who is probably known to most of you in the audience, who's been a dogged campaigner for the Hillsborough Justice Campaign. So I'll hand over to Sheila.
Thank you. I would like to thank Mark and Barbara for their outlining of the justice, the Orgreave campaign, which of course goes without saying the Hillsborough Justice Campaign totally supports and has supported since its inception. I think it's so important to realise, but in both their contributions and particularly in relation to what Barbara just said, that you know one of the reasons for declining an inquiry was there were no lessons to be learned for South Yorkshire Police. What a joke. You couldn't make that up. At the same time as they had been, you know, the South Yorkshire Police had been held up as being accountable in one sense around Hillsborough, they're saying there's no lessons to be learned. But for us, it's very important, because if the lessons of Orgreave had been learned all those years ago, there's a very strong argument that the Hillsborough disaster would not have happened. If the disaster had happened, the cover-up mightn't have happened. It was the fact that police could operate with impunity. And I have to say at the outstart that I'm quite mindful of what I can say, and I will be guided by Mark if he elbows me here, because of course now there are going to be prosecutions. We don't want to say anything which might prejudice those prosecutions, so I'm trying not to do that. For me, the point is the issue around state cover-ups, because Hillsborough marks a tremendous state cover-up over many, many years. And for many, many years, no one believed us. No one took any notice of us. And Mark's spot on. You know, in one sense, we didn't need officialdom to tell us the truth, because we knew the truth. And the sad fact of the matter is, we knew the truth because of eyewitnesses who were there, who were survivors on the day and were rescuers on the day. But instead of them being lauded as heroes, they were vilified as somehow complicit and responsible for the deaths. Moreover, individual campaign and families undertook their own research in spite of their grief and trauma and found the truth out for themselves. So we knew the truth, but it was not officially recorded. And it was important to have it officially recorded. And for the reasons Mark outlined, how do you go forward in society? How do you progress unless you right the wrongs? And we have a moral obligation, not only to right the wrongs, but to keep flagging up those miscarriages of justice where the state has fallen below a standard that we as citizens come to expect. Had we not fought around Hillsborough, Hillsborough would still be recorded as 96 deaths, accidental deaths, implicit in it being who was responsible, and it wouldn't have been the police or any agency. It was only a grassroots campaign that elevated it. And it was, and you know, thanks to Mark for the comments he made, which we really appreciated, and I'll carry those comments back to the wider campaign. But nevertheless, there were many years, and I've spoken here in previous years, where we had no support because there was no legal avenues that we were pursuing. And we had no support. We had no media support whatsoever. It wasn't considered newsworthy. But within that, there was a tremendous advantage because we were operating outside of everything. We just did what we wanted to. We weren't controlled by anyone. And I think there's lessons in that for people, very serious lessons. Because when the chips are down and you've got nothing to lose, you've got everything to fight for. So if we felt something was right to go for it, we'd go for it. Because there wasn't someone, oh, you might get sued for this, you might get... Because no one was advising us. We were, you know, you might consider it maverick, but we were actually like a tight little, it was like a war office, you know. We met every week in the room above a shop. We operated from a shop in Anfield in a very run-down area close to Liverpool Football Ground. You know, it was attached with Liverpool Football Club. They wouldn't even let our people in if they had an HJC sticker on. So that's an example of how the establishment closes ranks and excludes you if you're kind of a bit hardcore. But for me, the important thing there was it harnessed grassroots support. And, you know, Mark made reference to the families campaigning. But I would also, I'm always at pains to point out, particularly because of our own campaign, that it's survivors who played a crucial part. One, in terms of evidentially, but also as well, in terms of campaigning, the grassroots campaigns, a lot was Hillsborough survivors. And I'll always argue that the Hillsborough survivors are the forgotten victims of Hillsborough, because over many years, many have taken their own lives because they couldn't live with the guilt imposed on them by the state, by the media, and could not deal with their emotions. In the main, young men. And that is a tragedy in itself, and it's one that's never acknowledged. And I've always said I will always acknowledge the role of survivors, and I will never underplay the role they played in the fight for justice. They always deferred to families. They always took a step back. but they were the living tragedy of Hillsborough, and they still are forgotten victims. Just what I'd like to do is, just as an overview, because I think you're all probably very familiar with the whole Hillsborough issue around what happened and how it took so many years, etc., and how it was only last year we got the unlawful killing. But I think as an overall thing, I think you have to look at major miscarriages of justice where the state has been left wanting, and where there have been conspiracies and cover-ups, and the implications of those long-term, how people are co-opted over a lengthy period of time, and within that co-option comes a depoliticising of individuals and sometimes campaigns. The Bloody Sunday campaign, for example, how many years, I've said before, I personally drew a lot of inspiration in the dark years of Hillsborough, looking at Bloody Sunday families and what they were still fighting. So many years on from the Savile inquiry, we have a situation in Derry today where, and I'm sure the people won't mind me mentioning it, but in the Museum of Free Derry, there is an exhibition at the moment of victims of the Troubles. And there are pictures of soldiers alongside the dead of Bloody Sunday. There was no consultation on that to those people who lost people in Bloody Sunday. So victims of the Troubles between 69 and 1972... on these walls in Free Derry Museum include soldiers, UDR men, RUC men, alongside victims of the state. That, to me, is total contempt for the victims and families of Bloody Sunday. Innocent victims alongside those who murdered them. Who has allowed that to happen? Ask yourself what role Sinn Féin has played in that, and in terms of funding made available to that museum in order to have those soldiers there, a buy-off, co-opt, and something I feel very strongly about. Equally, people move on. We're now in a situation with the DUP, you know, governing us. Great. Whoever thought that would happen? You know, can you get your head round it? But the reality is, people see the Troubles. In this country, people see the Troubles if you're not really political. Oh, that's in the past, there's a peace process, etc. So what about people who still suffer the effects of discrimination in Ireland today? What about Tony Taylor, who is interned in McGabry Jail, having been brought back into prison? He was out on licence, being picked up and recently lost an appeal. Look into that case. Where's the publicity around that? Only at political events and certain political events will you say that. You won't get a mainstream campaign campaigning for Tony Taylor. What about the Craigavon 2, John Paul and Brendan? Two major miscarriages of justice that was supported by Gerry Conlon before he died, still supported by Paddy Hill of the Birmingham Six. You're not going to get it, are you? Because mainstream politics in Ireland doesn't want to know. It doesn't fit in to the revisionist history and the normalisation of the issues. And I use that as an example because, to a great extent, that's what I see happening with other campaigns. I see it happening with the Hillsborough campaign. I wrote a little piece in the Huffington Post the other week about it. The whole thing of when the prosecutions were announced, it was the work of our campaign was mentioned, but not once was the justice campaign mentioned. So the work is appropriated mainstream. There is a narrative, and it's who controls the narrative. And I feel very, very strongly around that, because some of the people who brought it to that stage are dead now. Bereaved families who fought and lost their lives fighting and looked because of neglecting their own health. And these people, for me, not only did they speak truth to power, they spoke truth as power. And that, to me, was our weapon. We had nothing, but we had the truth. And in the end, we battered down walls with that truth. But what happened along the way? Divisions occur. I'm sure this is familiar to all of you. And there will always be people who will be bought off. A lot of Hillsborough families did not want this seen outside of that narrow focus of Hillsborough and football, for that matter. It took a lot of arguing to get it recognised as a major miscarriage of justice. And along the way there, people have been co-opted. People, whilst the inquests were ongoing, took honours off the Queen. So whilst people are in court fighting the establishment, other people are taking trinkets off the establishment. Shame on them, I say. And I think of the bereaved families who had died, who weren't even there to argue the point with them. And what's happened very much is, as it become now, it's in the papers, it's brand Hillsborough, I call it, and celebrity Hillsborough. I find a lot of it distasteful. Just as when the Hillsborough panel report came out and then things started getting into the media and it become that we were going somewhere, ironically, that was the time at which people were bought off, at which they were co-opted politically and socially. Politicians who'd never really wanted to know got a grip of a few people. Socially, and by that I mean culturally, people were elevated to hanging out with kind of B-list celebrities, whatever, and were seduced by it. And that was a definite attempt at depoliticising the campaign, raising the people, a minority of people, to almost hero status, and the few, elevating the few at the expense of the many. Well, I won't let that happen. And other people in our campaign won't let that happen because I won't forget the many. And even last week when the prosecutions came out, and let's be clear about that, there's going to be 6 prosecutions. I'm not going to go into any details about that. Yeah, it was such a major leap forward from where we were a few years ago. But let's not forget, no organisation is being held to account. Whilst there may be individuals of organisations, but there are organisations that have been let off scot-free, and a lot of people are not happy with that. A lot of survivors aren't, and some of the families aren't. Jeremy Corbyn, I say we were ignored, but in Prime Minister Question Time, literally after it had been announced in Warrington, Jeremy Corbyn stood up and said, congratulated it and said, "This." And this is where you know you're doing something right, it's really good. He said, Jeremy Corbyn said, House of Commons, in the House of Commons, that this wouldn't have happened without the hard campaigning of the Hillsborough Justice campaign. Almost immediately, Theresa May jumped up and said, there's more than one campaign. And in particular, I would like to single out, and I'm not going to name the person, but the point is, there you have it. When you get singled out by Theresa May, you know, thank God. Well, you would be so ashamed, wouldn't you? You know. But the need to do that is crucial. The need for Theresa May to jump up and shout him down says you're doing something right as a campaign. They will not let you go there quietly, but we're not going anywhere quietly. The Grenfell Tower disaster, for me, is, apart from the obvious tragedy of it, it is such a major thing. We've been to Grenfell, we've spoken with people, we've offered our support and our continued support. The thing we've said and the thing that is so important is keep control of your own destiny as much as possible. I know there are divisions, there are people wanting to help, and there are divisions, there always will be. But keeping control of your own lived experience and your own destiny is crucial, and that is the advice we gave. And in terms of prioritising, I said to some of the families that I met with, lawyers will still be there next month. That's why solicitors' offices are on the high street these days. It's market forces, isn't it? For me, the two crucial things for victims and survivors and their families around Grenfell is, one, adequate and appropriate rehousing, but two, specialist trauma counselling and support, because I know from Hillsborough and from our campaign that we still receive family, people contacting us who have never had any counselling, survivors who were young people, who have married, had children, their families don't even know they were at Hillsborough. They're coming to us nearly 30 years later. Can you imagine the damage done? So my priority or my advice would be to Grenfell people is around trauma counselling and basically focusing on individual well-being. But in terms of what other people can do, and I think this is the point, don't let there be a state cover up on this one. We're all very cynical about it, but what we can do as a legacy to Grenfell is to make sure there is adequate social housing right across the country. There has to be a revolution in housing. I've made the point that personally it would give me no satisfaction seeing anyone go to prison for Hillsborough. That's a personal viewpoint. Not everyone holds to that. For me, the better legacy of Hillsborough would be that we lived in a more humanitarian society where lessons had been learned and where people, when they're faced with disaster, as Grenfell families have been, is that they don't go through what Hillsborough families went through. And more importantly, people learn lessons and let those lessons begin with Grenfell. Thank you.
I think all the speakers have raised really, really important points. There's a whole number of hands going up, so I want to try and get in as many speakers as we can. If people can come to the front so we can film you. If you don't want to be filmed, as I said, just let me know. But Paula first and this man second. I'll call people in twos. If you'll get 3 minutes. I'll tap on the mic after two. Don't feel you have to fill the 3 minutes. And if you want to just ask a question or you want to write a question, I'm happy to read it out for you. Okay, Paula.
Hi, Paula Peters, National Steering Group of Disabled People Against Cuts. Sheila, my friend Peter, I was supposed to be at that game at Hillsborough on the 15th of April, 89. I slid my tickets across the table to him because I was behind on my A-level work. He went to that game. It was Hillsborough every day until he died 12 years ago. I went to his grave the day that we found he was going to have prosecutions, and I said, justice is coming. And from him, his family, me, you'll never walk alone. You're always with us, and we thank you very much for that. And believe me, that took a lot for me to say, because I have a lot of survivor guilt. He was there and I was not, and I lived that every day. And to Mark and Barbara, my great-grandfather was a miner. He hated the police with everything in his heart because he was at the Striker, General Striker 26. And I tell you something now, Disabled People Against Cuts are with you because we know that miners are being persecuted under Atos and Maximus, and you tell them from us, we have their back and we are with them every fucking step of the way. We know our campaign is very different. But this government, we as disabled people are victims of the state, because there are thousands of disabled people who are being culled at the hands of this government, the Tories and the welfare reforms, the victims of the work capability assessment, the victims of personal independence payments, the victims of benefit sanctions and David Clapson, who the coroner said there was no causal link, and we know that there is. And this government are covering up the deaths of disabled people. They are covering up the United Nations Conventions of the Rights of People with Disabilities report. They won't implement it. Now, Deepak led a four-year fight to go to the UN, and we can tell you now that the Tories are the first government in the world to be investigated under the UNCRPD. They are the first state in the world to be found guilty of grave and systematic human rights violations under that convention. And in the next few months, Deepak will be meeting again with the UN, because where we're going now is into unprecedented territory to get justice for the thousands upon thousands of victims that are disabled people that have been denied their rights under this government. And this is a message to Theresa May. We will never let you bury that report. We will get justice for all disabled people. We're with Hillsborough and Orgreave. Solidarity.
I've got a man at the front, there's a young man at the back in a blue T-shirt. Can people keep their hands up so I can note you all down?
Yeah, mine is really a question. Because in my mind there's some confusion. I try to listen very, very carefully with a certain amount of cynicism in relation to the mass media. But there's been some discussion about the inquiry for Grenfell, that it will be incrementally taken up by the state. The state will find a way to control that inquiry. And I wondered if Mark or anybody else would like to comment the inquiry versus the inquest. People, some people have said a particular type of inquest. Inquest is the route to take, not the inquiry. And I wondered if the panel would want to comment on that. Thank you.
Hello, I'd just like to say thank you very much for the speakers for coming along, and it just shows that the unity of strength can take you a long way, so it's brilliant. There's also another state cover-up, and that's to do with contaminated blood scandal. I'm a haemophiliac, so I have a bleeding disorder, and in the 80s they gave people like myself and other people contaminated blood, and there's lots of people that died because of it, HIV. And there are lots of families that lost people as well. And it's a terrible disaster. And I think Andy Burnham has done a lot around this, and I think he's trying to push it. But supposedly, I've got relatives that were affected by it, and supposedly their records have now been lost, supposedly. So, obviously there's a long way, and there's lots of people on the ground that are really trying to push it, and they're trying to get it onto the national agenda. So I've just really want advice, really, in terms of activists on the ground. How can they push it to the level where it can become national agenda, and what... things they can do on the ground to involve as many people as possible. Cheers.
The next speaker will be the woman over there.
Hi, Joseph. I'm an SWP member. Yes, we know about state cover-up. How about this for further state subversion? Just gone again. Sorry. Can I keep putting my finger?
Carry on if he finds it.
Yeah, okay. It's an iconic photograph from the miners' strike, and it's the policeman holding the baton up high, and you see a woman on the left. This photograph was taken by a friend of mine, a journalist called John Harris, and he was threatened with being put on trial in Sheffield for falsifying the photograph. They said that he must have foreshortened it, otherwise the woman would have been hit, more likely killed, actually. And he was terrified of this case coming to court in Sheffield. He worked for a journalist who'd been a journalist in the Spanish Civil War, and his film in London was stolen. So he couldn't produce the film to say he hadn't foreshortened the photograph. What, though, authorities in this country never realize is that ordinary people will stand up. And Leslie Bolton said, "That was me. That is exactly what happened that day." And they tried to say, "Well, how come you weren't smashed around the head?" And if you see the full photograph, it drops quite a lot more. You'll see Leslie's friend round her elbow, crouched in her elbow. She pulled her to the ground and saved her from being smashed and possibly killed by the police. But they went to that sort of extent to say that John had falsified that photograph, threatened him with a trial, because that photograph was on our national press. It was one of the iconic photographs of the miners' strike. But thank goodness for us, for ordinary people, we will stand up for justice.
The man at the back will be next, yeah.
Thank you. Sue Wilde from Sheffield. I joined SWP in 1983, and 4 months later, it was the miners' strike. And before that, I went to a big picket at Warrington near Liverpool about a big print issue, and that was the first time I'd known anything to do with police at all, and they were just battening everybody, and I was stood there and they battened the two people each side, and the reason I were missed because I'm so short else I'd have finished up with a bloody head as well. But that was my first impression of police. And then when the miners' strike started, I mean, I've known Mark for years, and I've known Barbara because of the miners' strike. And I went to first Augreave, I'm sure it was the very first one. And When I went, there were no women there, only me, when I first went. And I was terrified when I saw all these police. And the only reason that I got through that was because of the miners and comrades that had gone with me. And it was I must admit, I went again to Orgreave, and I felt so lifted by it. The miners were absolutely magnificent, and I think they should never be forgotten, the miners. It was fantastic. I mean, when Mark were talking about arrested miners who spent time in the jail in Leeds, we had a miner come to a meeting. When Maggie Thatcher died, we had a great big celebration in Sheffield. And we went to a pub to celebrate. And this Yorkshire miner had been asked to come and speak at it. And he started speaking, and he just couldn't finish because it was still affecting him. It burst into tears, and it was still affecting him till this day, you know. So I'm just saying how much that affected him. And also, if you look at have you seen the Pride film, the great Pride film? Well, this T-shirt is to commemorate Mark Ashton, who was in that film. He was the gay young man that helped us get the miners, the gay community, to come and support the miners, which is fantastic. And there's a plaque just gone up at Marchmont Road near here as well, to commemorate Mark Ashton. So it just shows how great he is. My ex-partner was one of the ambulance drivers that went on the pitch, Tony Edwards. Yes. And he's been still affected by it. He went to court and everything as well, supporting the campaign, the justice campaign. So it has affected him as well. And it was true what you say, it still affects people. And what I'm saying is, I've been in party 30-odd years now, and I were only just an housewife with two kids when I joined. But I think it's really important that people go on the streets, on lobbies and everything. And if you want to do that and get the the Truth and Justice campaign, please do that, because join the party and get out and start doing it, because we'll never get it if you don't.
I've not seen anyone else indicate. But if you do want to... OK, you'll be next then. Thank you.
I am involved in the Orgreave campaign. I was at Orgreave, but not on the 18th. I was there on the 15th, and I got battered so badly that I couldn't make it for the 18th. But that's my story. But I don't want to talk about Orgreave to start with. I want to talk about Hillsborough and the inspiration that their campaign has given us, really. Without that, you know, we wouldn't be where we are. There's no doubt about that. But then again, if it hadn't been for Orgreave, there wouldn't have been a Hillsborough anyway. I want to also recommend a book, Hillsborough Voices, which I bought last year at Marxism. It's a fantastic read. I'd say it's a fantastic read. It's a hard read. You can't read it in one go. It's too poignant. There are too many hard lessons there, but it's worth it, you know, once you read it. It's a brilliant book, and I think it's out in paperback now, isn't it?
Yeah.
OK. So, and it's available in Marxism as well, so do buy that. Orgreave. The whole thing about Orgreave, it started about a month with the mass pickets before the 18th. And when they started, I think the 29th is when we start hearing about when people got went to hospital to nurse their injuries and what have you, they got arrested. So, I mean, obviously, what you're going to do then, if you do get injured, you're not going to go to hospital, you know, to get lifted by the coppers, you know. And that's one of the reasons why the statistics, you know, are not really right. You know, we don't count in the same way, you know. The other thing that clinks both campaigns is the disgraceful tabloid press, particularly The Sun, you know. And there's a campaign in Liverpool called Total Eclipse of the Sun, which I think people should support too, you know. But in terms of, there's lots of trade unionists in this room, I'm sure. Take the issue back to your branches, you know. But before you go, I just want to echo what Barbara said. We don't really cart anything back to South Yorkshire. I live in what was a mining village, you know, right in the heart of what used to be the Yorkshire coalfield, you know, and that it's still raw even now, you know. But we do have a problem, is that miners don't want to revisit it necessarily because it were a defeat, because they got battered both physically and politically by the strike. It's very difficult to revisit that whole thing again, you know. So we've got to do that for them. I wasn't a miner. I were on the picket because I'm a political activist, but you know, I'm not a miner. But we can do it for it. Get involved in the campaign. That's what I think we should do.
After the next speaker, I've not got anyone else to call. So if you want to, I've got a few minutes left. So if people do want, okay, I'll call Brian, and that will probably be the last speaker, okay?
Thanks, yeah. I come from a mining family in South Wales. My father was at Orgreave. I think it's important to say it was like a, I think Orgreave was a concentrated form of what was happening on the picket lines elsewhere throughout the strike. And give you a little story about a mate of mine who was picketing up in North Wales, a gang of strikers, pickets, miners, and they're having a bit of a talk with each other, a bit of a joke with each other, and the one lad is saying to another one, loud enough for the sergeant to hear, but they're having a laugh, saying, I wouldn't have minded being a copper back in the day, see, you know, and this copper's listening, and he said, the copper then says, oh, you wanted to be a miner? Police officer? Two Dell was you? No, he said my mother and father was married. So the copper went berserk, beat the boy up, truncheoned him, put him in hospital in North Wales for where they were picketing him for 3 days, and he got charged with assaulting the copper. I mean, luckily it went to court and it was thrown out. But there was violence meted on pickets like that all the time throughout the strike, you know, and it is still bitter. The last thing I want to say, when the film came out, Still the Enemy Within, a couple of years ago, we put that in a local working man's club in the village where I'm from, and it was about, I think it was about 40 people came to my father, helped put it on, etc. And there was a copper there, the local copper, John the Copper, we call him. He's retired now, isn't he? He never believed the boys in the village about what had happened in Orgreave until he seen the film. When he was actually in the club, he saw the film, he couldn't believe it. But one interesting thing that he said really struck home with me, he said, prior to the miners' strike, they were all sent, the coppers from the valleys, down to Newport for special training, for special riot training. So, you know, it was planned by the state. It was, and we shouldn't forget that, and all power to both campaigns. Thanks.
Okay, I think Brian's going to be the last speaker, unless anyone's got a little bit to come in, and then I'll call the speakers back in reverse order.
Brian. Comrades, writing in The Guardian on Thursday, George Monbiot argued that the Grenfell inquiry will be a cover-up. And he argued it will be a cover-up because if you allow the state to simply establish who the judge is going to be, act as the jury and sets the terms of inquiry, and sets those terms of inquiry as narrowly as they possibly can, you will end up with a cover-up. And if we do get a cover-up, it will be an absolute scandal because Grenfell tells you everything about the contempt with which the rich and powerful have treated working class people in this country for the last 30 or 40 years. Therefore, we have a duty to ensure that there isn't a cover-up and that there is the biggest exposure of this scandal that there possibly can be. And I think that the contributions that you've heard from the platform and from the floor this afternoon have given an indication of how that can happen. The fact that you have courageous journalists who are prepared to take pictures, produce films like that, is incredibly important. We had one of the best in that tradition, Paul Foote, as a member of our organisation for many decades, someone who died tragically far too young when he still had so much more to give. The fact that you have brilliant lawyers like Mark, like Matt Foote, like Michael Mansfield, who spoke on the platform yesterday, you know, the people, lawyers who are prepared to go the extra mile to stand up in the face of, you know, the posh, powerful judges and expose the reality matters. But I'm sure Mark, Michael, Matt, and all the others will say that as lawyers, you know, I wish I was half the lawyer that these guys are, but they are only able to do it because of the strength of the campaign behind them. And that is why what people like the Orgreave campaign, like the Hillsborough campaign have done, is so fantastically important. Think about the fact that people were not prepared to give up and accept that they were going to be beaten and downtrodden by the state and the gutter press is incredibly inspirational. Ordinary people who were just going about their lives as workers, as football fans in Grenfell, people who are just trying to live their lives in those towers, the fact people are saying they're not prepared to give up is fantastically important, and therefore we have a duty to support them. And one thing that has been so, one thing that people like the Hillsborough campaign, as the Lawrence family will say, is that their campaigns would not have been able to sustain themselves had it not been for the support up and down the country that they received from ordinary people, trade union branches and so on, that kept them going through the dark days. And therefore, the message has to be, you know, that from today, that we, you know, that the fight for justice for Orgreave, the continued fight for justice for Hillsborough victims, the fight for justice for Grenfell victims, the fight for justice for people who have been the victims at the hands of the police, deaths in custody, the most recent example, Edson da Costa, we have to go out and throw everything that we can into supporting those campaigns if real justice is to be achieved.
So without further ado, I will ask the speakers to sum up. First, Sheila. You could do it from here if you want.
Yeah, I'd just like to say that for me, from the Hillsborough Justice Campaign, aside from supporting the Orgreave campaign for the obvious reasons, it's so important that we support it because the experiences are intertwined, and until there is accountability around the role of South Yorkshire Police in Orgreave, then the whole Hillsborough issue will be unresolved. You have to see how a police force operated with impunity under Thatcher. You have to see that very strongly and powerfully, the consequences of that over a sustained number of years. So the two are linked, and I think that we have to show whatever support we can. State cover-ups have always gone on. I think the major difference now is, a big advantage now is technology. Had we had mobile phones the way we have them today, Hillsborough wouldn't have happened. There would have been phone calls made to people outside, etc., etc. So I think what we did within our campaign was utilise social media, the emergent social media, when we couldn't get anything out in mainstream press. We established our own website and basically said to people, come and get us if you want to sue us. And they never, ever did, because we were only telling the truth. That ability to then, as it progressed through Facebook and Twitter, we were able to harness great support. So, for example, we got through the first e-petition to be debated in Parliament, mainly utilising Twitter and Facebook. You know, that SOP to democracy from the last coalition government, of get 100,000 signatures and then you might get it debated. And we got 140,000 in just over a week when they never expected us. And actually, we did it three times. We went on to do it twice more. And so I think they put paid to that one. But the important thing is you can do that. And I say that in just finishing off now in relation to Grenfell. I think it's a fact that what is newsworthy today slips down in terms of being worthy and the priority, and also the political context means it slips further and further down. We have a responsibility to make, as the last speaker said, to make sure that doesn't happen, that we utilise social media and that we utilise our resources, any we have at a local level. My big thing is through local authorities, the issue of housing, keeping housing up there on the agenda so that Grenfell is not just seen as a one-off. And these people shouldn't have died, but if there has, they have, and that's the reality, it's heartbreaking. But the legacy has to be that change will come about for a better society. That will only happen, as rightly has been said, if we stand together and keep grassroots campaigns going and offer support in any way that they wanted to Grenfell residents. Thank you.
Hi, I'd just like to pick up on a couple of points. The Welsh guy, sorry, I can't see you now. Oh, you're there. Yeah. There were mini Orgreaves going off all over the landmass of the UK round the pit villages. It's just that Orgreave was the biggest and the most recognisable one. But there were mini Orgreaves going off all over pit villages, road blockages, people being arrested. And it's when you're being effective that the state steps up even further. I was on strike and I was on my local picket line at our office. We had no trouble with the police at all because we were ineffective. The state steps in when you're effective. And what happened at Orgreave is not an aberration. It's what the state does when you look as though you're going to achieve success. And to pick up on the point that Sheila made earlier about how important it is that whatever your campaign is, you remain in control of it. We all have to deal at the political and legal and campaigning level. You have to hit all those buttons continuously throughout your campaign. And at the political level, you can find yourself dealing with people that you'd prefer not to deal with, like Theresa May, like Amber Rudd, but whoever's in government, they've got the power to grant you what you're asking for. If you can persuade them. We didn't fail, the state failed us, but it's important that you remain independent and in charge of your campaign, and that gives you great flexibility to do what you want. We held our annual Orgreave rally a couple of weeks ago out at Orgreave, and we were under pressure to go and seek permission to hold a rally out at Orgreave. We never saw any permission at all. We were sent endless forms to be filled in by the local authority, and we just ignored them. We just informed the police, this is what we're doing. They said, all right, we'll come and we'll inform people who are coming in cars that they're going to be delayed while the march passes. Fine, you take all the flak from people who want to drive through and they can't. We were happy for them to do that. So, yeah, keep your independence. There is no shortcut to campaigning. The guy with the HIV campaign, there really isn't. It's exhausting and it's exhilarating. And you'll go up and you'll go down. And it's important that you do it with like-minded people. You need a collective approach to it because nobody's shoulders are broad enough to carry it on their own. And periodically, I go down more often than I'd like to, but I go down and I feel exhausted and I think I can't carry on doing this anymore. And then I get an email or I get a telephone call with an offer for a donation or a meeting. And all of a sudden, that weariness just leaves me. And I'm re-motivated all over again by the unexpected support. So if you're in a collective, when one goes down, there's always people around you to pick you up. And when they go down, you pick them up. No shortcuts, just bloody hard work.
Just 2 points from me. First of all, I should apologise for swearing a couple of times in my opening contribution. I don't normally do that in front of juries, although I feel like doing it in front of judges. I just want to deal with the question about inquest or inquiry. The answer is, why not have both? Yeah. In fact, there will be. There is a statutory duty to having inquests. In truth, the inquest cannot really go as far as an inquiry could in looking at the wider issues. One of the important things about having campaigning socialist lawyers is that we push at the boundaries. People like Brian, myself, Mike Mansfield, we have to work within the system, but we push at the boundaries. We got about as far as we could do, I think, in the Hillsborough inquest without them actually becoming inquiries, with the wide range of subjects. The cover-up actually has nothing to do with the actual deaths, but we've still forced the coroner into allowing a number of weeks of evidence about, he called it the evidence gathering, we called it the cover-up, you get the point. But there is no reason why you can't have both. The inquest can go quite far, quite wide-ranging, if the coroner is pushed by dedicated lawyers to do so. But you also need the inquiry. The problem, as you can see with inquiries already, is the government choose the judge, and they set the terms of reference. Well, the residents are doing the right thing. They're fighting and saying, no, hang on a minute. This is our inquiry. We want some input into the terms of reference, and that is obviously important. But the problem with these inquiries is the government choose what they call a safe pair of hands, a judge who will make sure that somehow or other the institutions of the establishment don't really get as much of a battering as they ought to get. And that's what we have to fight back against. But the answer is, we'll have both. We must ensure, on the experience of Hillsborough and Orgreave, that there is nothing like the delay or the attempt to cover up at Grenville as there was in both of those previous situations. And the final point I want to make is, the police are not neutral. I don't need to say that to you, but the people you talk to, you need to persuade that the police are not neutral. There was a photograph during the after the Manchester bombings, when there was the concert to raise money for the families and so on. There was a picture you probably saw of a copper dancing with a number of young people. Like, oh, aren't they cuddly? You know, this is what they do. They bash people over the head, as you can see from the pictures you've seen on the screen, because that's what they do when they're out there fighting for their, well, I say their class. Actually, most of them, of course, come from the working class. They are the worst of class traitors, because they are actually collaborating and being paid for by the enemy and fighting for the enemy against us. But please make sure that you, the people you talk to, your kids, grow up knowing that the police are no more neutral than the law is. The law is set by the establishment basically to make sure that society runs so that they can carry on making profits, of which Grenville is a perfect example. And it's our job, it's the job of all socialists, to make sure that people get the message. The law and the police are intensely political, and we have to explain to people what happens when we push the boundaries. And if you think this was bad, this wasn't close to revolution. And look what the state did then. You have been warned. This is what the police in capitalist society are like. Thank you.